When you don't oil the chain of your bike, the morning struggle to work gets harder every day, and you will probably have to replace some components of your bike more often. The oil functions as a lubricant that reduces the friction between your bicycle chain and the gear. This simple example shows how lubricants can affect the amount of work you have to apply to move your vehicle and how long your bike parts, like the gear and the chain, last. Lubricants are widely used in industry to reduce the effects of friction and wear. A typical car engine loses approximately 33% of its energy to friction. It is easy to imagine how much energy could be saved if lubricants were more effective. Although there is a push towards electric cars, these will still require lubrication. Even if all combustion engines in cars are replaced by electric motors by 2050, this will take much longer for ships. The Camp Research Group at the University of Edinburgh studies how lubricants work in collaboration with industry. The properties of lubricants are not well understood, despite their wide use. This is because they're very difficult to study while inside an engine. Also, lubricants are very complex, as they have many different components. A typical lubricant is made up of a base oil and around dozens of additives, each having a different function. Engines have a lot of parts that move very quickly and are very close together, so lubricants are essential to avoid these parts rubbing against each other and causing wear. Friction between these parts can also slow down the movement of the engine, which affects the performance and fuel efficiency of it. Some parts are not so close together, meaning that the pressure will vary a lot throughout the engine. Therefore, it is important to know how the lubricant behaves under different pressures, as we want the lubricant to maintain the same level of performance everywhere in the engine. Pressure refers to the physical force applied over the specific area of an object. It is defined as pressure P equals force F over area A, force per unit area. Liquids have uniform stress everywhere, so if some force is applied to a liquid, it will flow and distribute the stress from the force evenly across itself. A solid cannot flow, and so cannot do this. This work started by studying the simplest lubricant components, the base oil. It focuses on squalene, a good model base oil. Squalene is a hydrocarbon, meaning it only consists of carbon and hydrogen atoms. The study began with experimentalists looking at the high-pressure behavior of squalene using a diamond anvil cell. They found that squalene behaves very differently at high pressure. At pressure higher than 1 gigapascal, or GPa, it transitions into a solid. To illustrate how high that pressure is, let's go back to the elephant in high heels. An elephant is very heavy, and a high heel has very small area, so the pressure from that would be huge. Pressure is force per area. The elephant weighs about 6,000 kilograms, and the area of a stiletto heel might be 1 centimeter squared. That gives us 0.6 GPa, which is only just over half of the pressure the squalene is under when it solidifies. Diamond anvil cells are very useful tools for high pressure research. Two diamonds act as an anvil, in between which there's a hole where a sample can be loaded. A force can then be applied to the diamonds, squeezing them together and applying pressure on the sample inside. Diamonds are ideal for this due to their combined strength and hardness. Also, the transparency of the diamonds allows light to pass through them easily, making them ideal for scientists to study how the light interacts with the sample. This allows us to observe changes in behavior of the sample under pressure. In order to conduct these optical studies, rubies are also placed in the cell. The rubies absorb incoming light and then emit light at a lower energy. The energy of the emitted light will be different at different pressures, so we can use this to measure the pressure inside the cell. Researchers were able to see that squalene does not behave like a liquid at high pressure because the rubies and the squalene were not all at the same pressure, so it must not have uniform stress everywhere. To understand this behavior at a microscopic level, computational researchers can simulate what is happening and why. The computer simulations mimic what atoms do in real life based on the forces that operate between the atoms. We can predict how these forces will affect the behavior of the atoms by solving Newton's laws of motion. The simulation time is split into time steps. At each time step, we compute the force acting on each atom using a force field which tells us how the atoms interact with each other. We then use Newton's law of motion to update the position and velocity of each atom. This technique is called molecular dynamics. Here you can see a movie from a molecular dynamics simulation of 500 squalene molecules. As we increase the pressure in the simulation, we can see that the squalene molecules are being packed together much more closely. At very high pressures, above 1 GPa, we can see that the squalene can no longer move around, and it is stuck in one configuration, like a solid would be. We can measure how much the individual atoms are moving throughout the simulation. As we increase pressure, the diffusion drops rapidly, and at high pressure we can see that nothing is really moving. This fits very well with the idea that solidification is taking place. We can also measure other properties with these simulations. Viscosity is a measure of how easily a fluid can flow. Generally, thicker fluids will be more viscous. For example, honey has a much higher viscosity than water. Viscosity is a very important property because the lubricants need to be able to flow around the engine. We can measure the viscosity by applying force to the squalene, making it flow, and then monitor how it responds. We can see from the simulation that as pressure increases, the viscosity increases rapidly. So why does the squalene become solid under pressure? We assumed it must be due to the structure of the squalene changing somehow. In a simulation, this can be measured by something called the radius of gyration, which tells us something about the shape of the molecules. A low radius of gyration would mean that the molecules are scrunched up, and a high radius of gyration would mean that the molecules are stretched out. At low pressures, the radius of gyration increases slowly due to the molecules all lining up and stretching out. At high pressure, the radius of gyration decreases dramatically, showing that the molecules are being crushed together and changing shape. The simulation results confirmed that there was a solidification process taking place, as initially observed by the experimentalists. The simulations also managed to shed some light on why this was happening. This is important for lubricant development going forward. A lubricant should not easily become solid under pressure, since this could lead to it jamming up an engine. So I'm here with Iain, who's been doing a lot of the work for this project, and I would like to ask him a few questions. So the first question I have for you is, can you tell us a little bit about the difference in terms of an undergraduate research project and sort of PhD research?
So in the PhD I've got a lot more freedom. So as long as I'm getting my work done, I can do it however and wherever I want. And I've also got some input into the overall direction of my project. And just in general, you get a lot more opportunities to work on new things that no one's ever done before. So it's definitely a lot more interesting.
That sounds really exciting. I guess the next question I have is, you're a theoretical chemist, but you got the opportunity to work with an experimentalist. How's that been?
So it can be challenging, as I have to find a way to explain what I'm doing to someone who's maybe never run a simulation before. But it's also really rewarding to see someone doing my theoretical work in real life. And sometimes my results can even guide what experimentalists are doing, so that's really nice to see.
Yeah, that sounds really rewarding indeed. And I understand part of it was also an industrial collaboration, so how has it been working with industry?
So again, you have to find the right way to communicate your work. So in general, industry are very results-focused. They're not really that interested in your methods or how you did it. They just want to know, what are the results, what do they mean, and really what can we do with them? So it really helps you to think more about the context of your work and about the broader impact of what you're doing.
Hmm. Yeah, that makes sense. I guess I have one last question for you. So you're kind of approaching the finish of your PhD. Where do you want to go next?
So at the moment I'm planning to stay in academia, hopefully in a postdoctoral research position at another university. So that would be pretty similar to what I'm doing now, but I would have a bit more independence. I could also continue research in industry, but I would have a lot less flexibility there than I would in academia, so at the moment I prefer academia. But there's also a lot of other options. I don't have to stay in research. You know, the computational and programming skills I've developed during the PhD would be really useful in a lot of different roles in the tech industry, so really a lot of options.
That sounds fantastic. Well, best of luck to you.
Thank you.
Thank you.